now and online at kpfa.org. It is 1 p.m. Stay with us for Guns and Butter.
This is Guns and Butter.
Something happening, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
What it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a gun over there.
From the point of view of U.S. military planners, Syria and Iran are part of the same process. The U.S. military does not plan these war theaters in a separate way. They have a single decision-making process. They view the interaction between these war theaters. They have a long war perspective. This is stated in U.S. military documents. It's the long war. It's the war without borders. It's a hegemonic agenda. It's a global war. It's what we have called the globalization of war. We have discussed and spoken about a World War III scenario.
I'm Bonnie Faulkner. Today on Guns and Butter, Michel Chossudovsky. Today's show, Iran and the Globalization of War. Michel Chossudovsky is professor of economics and director of the Center for Research on Globalization, based in Montreal, Quebec. He is the author of The Globalization of Poverty and the New World Order, War and Globalization, The Truth Behind September 11th, and America's War on Terrorism. He is co-editor and contributor to a new anthology, The Global Economic Crisis, The Great Depression of the 21st Century. Today we discuss recent developments in the Middle East, including the wider implications of the destabilization of the entire area, the current global war as a different kind of conquest than that of World War I and II, U.S. military deployment in the area, the role of Israel, Iranian defenses, U.S. war planning and war scenarios since 2003 concerning the nation of Iran, including Austere Challenge 12, Theater Iran Near Term, Global Strike 2003, Concept Plan 8022, and Vigilant Shield, the effect of sanctions and the responsibility to protect. Michel Chossudovsky, welcome.
I'm delighted to be on the program.
There's a lot going on in the Middle East, the so-called Arab Spring with the overthrow and attempted overthrow of Arab governments in Tunisia, Egypt, Libya, Syria, etc. A real upheaval is occurring, not to speak of the U.S. invasion and occupation of Afghanistan and Iraq and the destabilization of Pakistan, a nuclear power. Now we have renewed and very serious saber rattling against Iran, including more severe sanctions, war games, threats against Iran's nuclear program. Through what lens do you view the wider implications and causes of the current turmoil in the region as a whole?
Well, certainly the war rattling in relation to Iran is at this stage the most important issue. I would say it's perhaps the most important issue in world history, because there has been a massive deployment of military hardware, the sending of U.S. troops to Israel, to Kuwait, 15,000 troops to Kuwait, 9,000 troops to Israel. The redeployment of these troops was contingent upon the reduction of U.S. military presence in Iraq. And so that a new war theater is unfolding where the United States and its allies are virtually surrounding Iran. If you look at the map, you see military bases in the Arabian Peninsula, in the Persian Gulf, of course, in neighboring Pakistan and in Afghanistan. At present, we may distinguish between four active war theaters in the broader Middle East, Central Asian region, namely the so-called AFPAC war, the fact that the war in Afghanistan is spilling over into Pakistan, and in fact, there's an undeclared war between Pakistan and the United States. Of course, Iraq, and that war continues despite the withdrawal of troops, or at least the partial withdrawal of troops. Palestine, not exactly the same kind of war theater as Afghanistan and Iraq, but nonetheless territories which are militarized, occupied, and which are very important in the context of U.S., Israeli, Middle East geopolitics. And then we have, of course, Libya, which is a country recently invaded by NATO forces and which has been devastated with more than 11,000 strike sorties, more than 50,000 missiles and bombs launched on a population of 6 million people. So that is the equation. There are separate war theaters, but if Iran is attacked, all those war theaters ultimately will coalesce into a regional war, because Iran has borders with Pakistan, it has borders with Afghanistan, with Iraq, Syria is an ally of Iran. The United States and its allies are attempting to destabilize Syria through covert operations. This is well documented, that the vents inside Syria are the product of an armed insurgency, which is supported and financed by foreign powers, including the United States, Israel, Turkey, and Saudi Arabia. And that ultimately the purpose is to destabilize Syria, to implement regime change, and that from the point of view of U.S. military planners, Syria and Iran are part of the same process. The U.S. military does not plan these war theaters in a separate way. They have a single decision-making process. They view the interaction between these war theaters. They have a long war perspective. This is stated in U.S. military documents. It's the long war. It's the war without borders. It's a hegemonic agenda. It's a global war. It's what we have called the globalization of war. We have discussed and spoken about a World War III scenario. And indeed, we are in a World War III scenario. But we should also understand that this war is very different from the previous two so-called world wars. It is using the most advanced weapon systems. It is applying what some analysts have called asymmetric warfare, where you go into a country, you destabilize its institutions, you send in covert operations of special forces, you implement drone attacks, and so on. Namely, we're no longer within the realm of conventional war with opposing troops and armies and tanks. Those, of course, are still used and are significant, but there's a whole gamut of procedures from cyber warfare, the disabling of enemies' communication systems, to climatic warfare, the use of environmental modification techniques, well documented, not discussed neither in military or scientific circles, but relevant to the conduct of modern warfare, and a whole gamut of other techniques, including, of course, biological and chemical weaponry. So that what is at stake today is the most formidable deployment of military might in world history. It's the vast array of military bases, of U.S. military bases worldwide, the aircraft carriers, the strike groups, the air force, the missiles, all of which is coordinated centrally, I should emphasize, centrally by U.S. Strategic Command. We are no longer in the framework whereby wars can be planned on the ground or regionally. When confronting an enemy such as Iran, decisions take place at U.S. Strategic Command. They're part of a global military agenda. This is entitled a global strike under what U.S. Strategic Command calls the concept plan. And these are coordinated plans using, of course, satellites, advanced communication systems, to wage war in different parts of the world and to coordinate the actions of the different entities of the U.S. military as well as allied forces. Now, this pertains to the deployment of weapon systems and attack strategies, but it also pertains to air defense systems, which are of crucial importance in modern warfare, because the weapon systems are so advanced that you want to make sure that your enemy is not going to retaliate in any meaningful ways, so that your air defense system has to be absolutely 100%. And in the case of a war on Iran, Iran will retaliate. This is something which is well understood. Iran will retaliate. And the U.S. military and its allies, including Israel, have been building scenarios of that retaliation for years, because the war on Iran has been in the pipeline at least since 2003, in the immediate wake of the Iraq war. And what has withheld actions against Iran is precisely the ability of Iran to retaliate with an advanced missile system, guided missile system, which would inevitably be directed against U.S. military facilities in the Persian Gulf, in Afghanistan, in Iraq, but also targets in Israel, which inevitably would result in civilian casualties. We must understand that Israel is playing a subordinate role in these war plans. There's been a lot of debate and discussion and confusion regarding the role of Israel. But Israel cannot, under any circumstances, wage aerial attacks against Iran without the green light from the Pentagon. And the reason for this is that in 2008, the U.S. military, in cooperation with Israel, reformed the air defense system of Israel with a new radar system and integrated Israel's air defense system into that of the United States and NATO. So that from a logistical point of view, Israel cannot wage a war without coordinating with its allies, namely the United States and NATO. And also in 2005, Israel and NATO signed a protocol agreement which makes Israel essentially a de facto member of the Atlantic Alliance.
I'm speaking with economist and director of the Center for Research on Globalization, Michel Chossudovsky. Today's show, Iran and the Globalization of War. I'm Bonnie Faulkner. This is Guns and Butter. Can you describe the Iranian military capability?
Well, I think we must first of all acknowledge that Iran is a significant military and economic power in the Middle East. It has advanced missile capabilities. It has an extensive air force. It has the capacity to mobilize virtually overnight approximately 1 million troops, namely, as it stands, it has in excess of 500,000 active military and reserve forces of the order of 650,000. In addition to that, it has the Revolutionary Guards, which have their own hierarchy and structure. Iran is a country of 80 million people. It is classified among the top military powers in the world, next to Germany and Israel. It has been preparing for these U.S. attacks, I would say, for the last 10 years. In other words, a large share of its oil revenues have, in fact, been used to build up its air defense system. It has the S-300 Russian system. It has its own capabilities. It has a military industrial complex of its own. From a military standpoint, most probably Iran would lose a war with the United States and NATO. But what we can say is that that process of that war would not necessarily lead to a straightforward victory of the United States, despite its military superiority. What we can say is that a war with Iran would result in a large amount of civilian casualties. And those casualties would not be limited to Iran. They would also occur in the Persian Gulf, in the Gulf states, which are allies of the United States, which are slated to participate in this military operation. I'm not suggesting that that is going to occur, but that there have been massive shipments of weapons to Saudi Arabia and the Gulf states. That took place about 2 years ago. The Pentagon announced proudly that it had sold something of the order of $50 billion worth of military hardware to Saudi Arabia. And there were also similar sales to the Gulf states. And those weapons are, in effect, really part of the U.S. arsenal. They're purchased by Saudi Arabia, but they're stationed in the Persian Gulf, and they are coordinated by U.S. military advisors who are there. And ultimately, if they're to be used, they'll be used as part of a U.S.-led coalition directed against Iran. So that the casualties will be extensive in Iran, in neighboring countries, but also in Israel. And this is something which U.S. military analysts are fully aware that any kind of military action against Iran would immediately lead to retaliation, and Israel would be the target. That is assuming, of course, that Israel is part of this military alliance, which it is. And in that regard, I think we have to understand that one of the first victims of this war are the people of Israel. I'm not talking about the government, I'm talking about the people of Israel, who have been betrayed by their government, and a government which, in effect, would be instrumental in the destruction of Israel. Because immediately that whole region flares up, the war would inevitably extend into Lebanon and Syria, And that is, in fact, part of the military agenda of this alliance. And we would have a situation of confrontation between the Lebanese forces, which are essentially made up of Hezbollah, the Syrian forces. I should mention that Russia has a naval base in southern Syria, in Tartus. And the Russians have recently made a very important statement to the effect that if the security of Iran is threatened, that they will consider this as a threat to Russian security, which signifies that Russia is an ally of Iran, it is also an ally of Syria, and that if military action is directed against Iran or Syria, Russia could intervene in the conflict, and there we are essentially in a World War III scenario.
Who is in charge of the Central Bank of Israel, and what is significant about this person?
The ties between Israel and the United States are not limited to the military spheres, to the spheres of intelligence, military technology, armed forces. There are overlapping economic ties. And one thing which I think is very significant is that a few years back, the deputy managing director of the International Monetary Fund, who in effect is a U.S. citizen, was appointed governor of the Bank of Israel. A few years back, the deputy managing director of the International Monetary Fund, Stanley Fischer, was appointed governor of the Central Bank of Israel. The Central Bank of Israel plays a key role in financing the military agenda. It's the instrument of money creation. It overshadows the allocation of government expenditures to different categories of spending. It performs essentially within Israel the same role as the Federal Reserve performs in the United States of America. The central bank ultimately calls the shots on where the economy is going. And the fact that this position, this key position in Israel is held by an individual who is a U.S. citizen and who has a financial career at the IMF and on Wall Street, I think is of utmost significance.
Is there planning for American troops to be stationed in Israel long term?
In recent developments, the United States has sent some 9,000 troops to Israel. This happened virtually overnight at the beginning of January 2012. It has not been reported in the Western media. And these troops were intended to be attached to the conduct of major war games between the United States and Israel. But in effect, what's going to happen is that these troops are actually going to be stationed in Israel in the wake of the war games. So this is a very important and significant shift. There's going to be a permanent U.S. military presence in Israel with U.S. troops. There's already a large contingent of U.S. advisors. There's a very close relationship between the Pentagon and the Israeli Ministry of Defense and the Israeli Armed Forces. And Israel is being used to launch military, U.S.-sponsored military operations in that region.
And why is a war against Iran not in Israel's best interest?
Well, that's a very important question. We might recall that a few years back, there was a controversy regarding a statement allegedly made by President Ahmadinejad to the effect that Israel should be wiped off the map. And in fact, that statement was never made. It was a fabrication of the U.S. media. And what Ahmadinejad had actually said was that history will tell us that Israel will be removed from the page of history. There have been translations and analysis of that statement, but never did he actually point to any action by Iran to destroy the state of Israel, but simply saying that the regime in Israel will become obsolete. It will no longer exist historically, namely pointing to the Zionist entity. That statement, in effect, was used by U.S. foreign policymakers not only to create an aura of panic within Israel, but also to build a casus belli directed against Iran, a thematic justification that because the Iranians wanted Israel to be wiped off the map, we should come to the rescue of Israel and we should wage a preemptive war against Iran so that that would prevent them from doing what they had said they wanted to do, which is to wipe Israel off the map. All of which points to the falsehoods of the Western media, which portray Israel as the victim and which portrays Iran as the threat to global security, not only to the security of Israel, but to the security of the Western world, when in fact, if we look at the facts, we can see that the major threat to global security is the United States and NATO, which are waging war simultaneously in different regions of the world. Is this war on Iran in the interest of Israel? Is this war there to prevent Iran from attacking Israel? The answer to that question is no. That war will ultimately unleash a response by Iran. Iran has no interest in attacking Israel if Israel doesn't attack Iran. But in the case where the United States and Israel wage aerial bombardments directed against Iran, Iran will retaliate. And that act of retaliation is known and understood by U.S. military planners, who are prepared to designate Israel as a collateral damage. The people of Israel are the collateral damage of U.S. foreign policy, of U.S. War plans. Because if any kind of military action is unleashed against Iran, there will be retaliation against targets in the Middle East, including Israel. So that, in effect, who is wiping Israel off the map? It's President Obama. It's not President Ahmadinejad, because President Obama has ordered an attack on a country which has the right to defend itself, and it will defend itself in the form of retaliation against those who have attacked it, namely Israel and the United States.
I'm speaking with economist and director of the Center for Research on Globalization, Michel Chossudovsky. Today's show, Iran and the Globalization of War. I'm Bonnie Faulkner. This is Guns and Butter. What is Austere Challenge 12?
The United States and Israel are currently involved in what is described as the most advanced and the largest war games in Israeli history. And these war games, entitled Austere 12, are there essentially to test Israeli air defense systems in the case of a war directed against Iran. The framework of these war games and the timing is crucial, because in the last few months, Iran has been conducting war games. In fact, it completed a set of war games in late December. And the United States and Israel are now planning to wage their own war games. These war games also serve as a show of force to Iran. They're there to intimidate their enemy, and to indicate that the United States and its allies are prepared to wage war on Iran if certain conditions are not met.
What is Theater Iran near term war planning, termed TIRANNT, or tyrant?
Since 2003, the United States has been involved in war preparations directed against Iran, and in fact, it has also conducted a number of war scenarios or war games. And Theater Iran near term was one of the first war games conducted in the immediate wake of the war on Iraq. It was conducted, in fact, in May of 2003, barely 1 month after the completion of theater operations by the U.S. military in Iraq. Now, Theater Iran near term are war games and simulations which are based on this notion of global strike, concept plan A022, which consists in actual plans of the Navy, the Air Force, which are then translated into strike packages against a specified enemy. Theater Iran near term essentially replicated the blitzkrieg, the shock and awe bombing campaign, which commenced in March of 2003, directed against Iraq. It at least confirmed the fact that the U.S. military had already identified several thousand targets inside Iran as part of this military agenda. The notion that the United States would be conducting limited strikes or surgical strikes has to be questioned, because the war games that they've conducted invariably involve a much broader air campaign, which inevitably could also, you know, evolve towards a ground war. Now, a few years later, in 2006, the Pentagon launched another set of simulations under what was called Vigilant Shield. And these exercises of particular interest because they essentially build a scenario of global warfare. The war simulations are not limited to a single Middle East war theater, as in the case of Tyrant. They also include Russia, China, and North Korea. And it's interesting to point out that in these war games, you never identify the country by its actual name, so that the names of the enemies of America on the Vigilant Shield are Ermingham, Iran, Nemesis, North Korea, Rubek, Russia, and Shuria, China. And essentially, Vigilant Shield is a scenario for World War III because it shows how actions by Iran, missile testing and so on, are then followed by actions by Rubek and Shuria, Russia and China, and that there's a whole sequence of events. Essentially, in Vigilant Shield, the United States of America is the object of a military operation by this alliance of rogue states, and of course also the war games are there to build a consensus among top decision makers that the threat is real and that Shuria, Rubek, Ermingham, and Nemesis are the enemies of America and are threatening America, and this is the framework which is presented on the Vigilant Shield.
And what is the road to conflict provision in Vigilant Shield 07?
It's interesting to point out that in the details and sequencing of Vigilant Shield, where Ermingham, Nemesis, Rubek, and Shuria are identified, there's a so-called road to conflict. And it starts when Ermingham starts nuclear enrichment, and then when Rubek and Ermingham are involved in military cooperation, and then it evolves towards a situation where Rubek closes its U.S. embassy in Washington, and then the Rubeki Russian president makes a statement on a possible U.S. attack, but in fact what happens is that Rubek attacks the United States. And then there's a media campaign which discredits the Russian, the Rubek president, and so on. This set of simulations has all different aspects of diplomatic interaction, warfare, and so on. And we should understand that most of the simulations and war games are not made public. And these two war games stand out because we have limited information on their features and characteristics. But there have been lots of other war games conducted by the U.S. military, which are more sophisticated, more advanced, and which have not been released to the public domain. But I'm certainly convinced by my understanding of military planning that there is a global military agenda. There's a sequencing of military operations, yet if you look at the project for the new American century, they clearly specify that military operations are not necessarily to be conducted consecutively, and that the United States is involved or should be involved in major theater operations in different parts of the world simultaneously. So that there is sequencing, but there's also this notion of waging simultaneous actions in different parts of the world, and that is the situation which ultimately prevails today. We see the U.S. military involved in the Middle East and Central Asia, but they're also involved in the Horn of Africa, in Somalia in particular, in southern Sudan. They have various covert operations in different parts of the world. They're threatening China. They're threatening Russia. So that we are within the framework of global warfare.
Now, do the Vigilant Shield 07 war simulations also function as internal propaganda with a view to developing a preemptive war consensus within U.S. elites? You write about this.
Well, the United States and its allies have conducted over the years what they call top-off exercises. Top-off exercises, in fact, were conducted under the auspices of Homeland Security, and they were addressed to top officials, as the code of the games indicates. But these top-off exercises were, in effect, geared towards preventing acts of terrorism in the United States. So it was within the realm of the war on terrorism. But more broadly, war games are also there to convince top decision makers in the military, in law enforcement, in civilian government, that the enemy is real, that there's a threat. I think that war games generally serve several purposes. They certainly feed the decision-making process of actual military planning. But there's another very important function. They're there to create a consensus at the top levels of the military, but also within the realm of civilian politics, of top decision makers within America, that the war is justified, that the threat is real, that the enemies want to attack America, that we have to defend ourselves, because ultimately, they build scenarios where the United States is defending itself against a known enemy. And in the case of Vigilant Shield 07, it's Russia and China and Iran and North Korea, which are the rogue states, which are attacking America, and they constitute members of the Axis of Evil, and we have to defend ourselves, and so on and so forth. So that these simulations are ultimately, the simulations are there to convince the participants that the threat is real and that America needs to defend itself, and therefore preemptive warfare is a valid objective of U.S. military doctrine.
I'm speaking with economist and director of the Center for Research on Globalization, Michel Chossudovsky. Today's show, Iran and the Globalization of War. I'm Bonnie Faulkner. This is Guns and Butter. How likely do you think a war pretext or provocation incident is, or a false flag type scenario?
Well, at the present juncture, there's a massive buildup of U.S. military might in the Middle East with the transfer of 9,000 troops to Israel, 15,000 troops to Kuwait, the deployment of aircraft carriers in the Arabian Sea, the war games which are planned both by the United States and Iran, to the extent that an incident in the Persian Gulf, in the Strait of Hormuz, could lead to confrontation at a military level between Iran and U.S. allied forces. Whether this confrontation would be actually triggered by the United States and that Iran would fire the first shot, that remains to be established. But if we look at U.S. history, we know that from the Spanish-American War onwards, this has been the strategy of the U.S. military. There's a continuum in U.S. military history. A casus belli, a cause for war, has always been sought with a view to establishing public support for the war. And we might ask ourselves, is the Obama administration prepared to sacrifice one or more vessels of the Fifth Fleet, which is stationed in Bahrain, which would result in extensive casualties among soldiers and sailors? And this would be implemented with a view to mustering public support for a war in Iran on the grounds of self-defense. Bearing in mind the history of war justifications, this is something which could be envisaged by military planners. There certainly acts of provocation which are occurring at this very moment with these war games.
Well, now, there have been a series of economic sanctions put on Iran, and there's a new set in the works. Now, how are these sanctions against Iran affecting Iran generally? There are sanctions against the Iranian Central Bank now, isn't there?
Yes, let me first say that these sanctions directed against Iran are predicated on the fact that Iran has a nuclear weapons program. And the irony is that coinciding with the implementation of those sanctions, which was on the 31st of December, when President Obama actually approved the sanctions regime, Leon Panetta, the U.S. Defense Secretary, went live on network television and stated unequivocally, I quote, "Are they trying to develop a nuclear weapon? No," unquote. In other words, the U.S. Secretary of Defense has in effect told us that the pretext for imposing the sanctions is invalid. And this has also had an impact on the way U.S. allies have responded to the sanctions regime. Yes, the U.S. sanction regime on the Iranian Central Bank have been devastating. They've led to a massive collapse in the Iranian rial, the Iranian currency. Yet, with regard to Iran's oil exports, both Russia and China have refused to abide by these sanctions. But these are sanctions imposed by the U.S. administration and the U.S. Congress. They're not sanctions which are imposed by the United Nations Security Council. So China has said no, and very categorically. And the Russians have said the same. And in fact, the Russians have even stated that they will stand by Iran militarily if Iran is attacked. With regard to the oil exports, China relies heavily on Iran. In fact, 22% of China's oil requirements are in the form of imports from Iran. So that is a very significant amount of oil. And consequently, I don't see that Iran will necessarily, that its oil industry will be paralyzed as a result of these sanctions, because both Russia and China have emphasized that they will not enforce the sanctions regime. And I would suspect that while the Europeans have paid lip service to the sanctions regime, in effect, there will be a number of loopholes. And at least from that standpoint, the Iranian oil industry stands firm in relation to Western threats.
And what do you think of the Iranian threat to close the Strait of Hormuz and the back and forth with regard to these threats?
Well, that is, of course, a very complex question. I think it's important to understand that the Strait of Hormuz is a very narrow canal, passageway between the Gulf of Oman and the Persian Gulf. And it is very difficult for U.S. warships or for general cargo vessels to transit through the Strait of Hormuz without going through Iranian territorial waters. Now, to this effect, in recent developments, the Iranian parliament has been re-evaluating the use of Iranian waters at the Strait of Hormuz by foreign vessels. And in fact, they've passed legislation, or they're passing legislation, which would block foreign warships from going through Iranian territorial waters without seeking the permission of the Iranian authorities. That is what is at stake. Because at this juncture, it is very difficult to transit through that narrow passageway without either entering into Iranian territorial waters or on the way out through the territorial waters of Oman. It's a passageway in terms of width, the number of islands there, which is less than 100 kilometers wide.
And finally, Michel, what is the responsibility to protect?
The responsibility to protect is part of this humanitarian mandate. It's a fabricated concept. It states that NATO has the responsibility to protect the populations of countries which have authoritarian governments or where democracy does not prevail as it prevails in Western countries. And so that responsibility to protect means that you can go into a country, bomb the hell out of the country, with a view to instating democracy. And this was the logic of NATO's intervention in Yugoslavia in 1999. It was also the logic underlying the intervention in Libya last year, 2011, to the fact that you intervene with the support of the United Nations Security Council with a view to protecting people in that country, protecting Libyans against their own government. But in effect, that whole notion was based on lies and fabrications, particularly with regard to Libya, where the country was literally destroyed. Its infrastructure was destroyed, its water system, its food distribution system, its institutions, its schools and universities were bombed, healthcare centers were bombed. None of this was really reported in the media, except with regard to a minimal coverage on so-called collateral damage. We didn't mention the fact that the so-called rebels were integrated by Al-Qaeda-affiliated organizations, the Libya Islamic Fighting Group. They were the foot soldiers of NATO. They were supported by U.S. intelligence operatives on the ground, and in fact that this was a NATO invasion of a sovereign country. Whether we like the leader of that country or not is not the issue. And for many years, the war in Iran has been on the Pentagon's drawing board. Oil is the trophy of this war on Iran. In other words, what the United States and its allies wants to do is to break up the Iranian oil industry, reprivatize it, and hand it over to the United States and British oil companies. We must understand that the Anglo-Persian oil empire was a British project of what is now called British Petroleum, previously called the Anglo-Persian Oil Company, and that the oil wealth in Iran was, in fact, the very basis for the development of British Petroleum as one of the largest world corporations in the oil business. So that what the United States and its allies want, it's an Anglo-American project, is to reconquer those oil reserves and confiscate the assets of the Iranian oil industry. That is the unspoken objective of this war, and the U.S. media is misleading us into believing that somehow We are waging this war to protect Israel from Iran and to make the world safer by going after Iran and its allies. And I should also mention that both Russia and China are fully aware of the fact that the war on Iran is ultimately the stepping stone to a broader war directed against the two remaining competing powers in the world, namely Russia and China. And it's not by accident that in the latest allocations of the U.S. Defense budget that much emphasis has been placed on the militarization of the Pacific and the South China Sea. Why? Because essentially that is where the U.S. military wants to place its forces for the future, challenging, of course, the growing role of China in the Asia-Pacific region.
Michel Chossudovsky, thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm delighted to be on the program.
Something happening, yeah. Yeah, yeah. What it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a gun over there.
I've been speaking with Michel Chossudovsky. Today's show has been Iran and the Globalization of War. Michel Chossudovsky is director of the Center for Research on Globalization, based in Montreal, Quebec. The global research website, globalresearch.ca, publishes news articles, commentary, background research, and analysis on a broad range of issues. Michel Chossudovsky is the author of The Globalization of Poverty and the New World Order, War and Globalization, The Truth Behind September 11th, and America's War on Terrorism, as well as numerous articles. He is a co-editor and contributor to a new anthology, The Global Economic Crisis, The Great Depression of the 21st Century. Many economists and investigative journalists have contributed to this new volume. Visit the Center for Research on Globalization website at www.globalresearch.ca. That's globalresearch.ca. Guns and Butter is produced by Bonnie Faulkner and Yaro Mako. To leave comments or order copies of shows, email us at blfaulkner@yahoo.com. That's blfaulkner@yahoo.com. Visit our website at www.gunsandbutter.org. That's gunsandbutter.org.
Revolution, which is the evolution of the mind. If you seek, then you shall find that we all come from the divine. You dig what I'm saying? Now, if you take heed to the words of wisdom that are written on the walls of life, then universally we will stand, and divided we will fall, because love conquers all. You understand what I'm saying? This is a call to all you sleeping souls. Wake up and take control of your own cipher, and be on the lookout for a spirit sniper trying to steal your life. You know what I'm saying? Look what this side yourself. For peace, give thanks, live life, and release. You dig me? You got me?
To celebrate 15 years of service, Berkeley Nonprofit Community Works is proud to present the Bay Area premiere of Through the Night, Obie Award winner Daniel Betty's one-man show. A child of an incarcerated parent, Daniel Betty is an electrifying performer whose work parallels Community Works' mission of empowering youth and families impacted by incarceration. The New York Times called Through the Night a thing of beauty with wit, grit, and piercing lyricism. The event will take place February 11th at 7 p.m. at Brava Theater in San Francisco. Tickets are $40 and can be purchased at brava.org. Social justice activists Sujatha Baliga and Nell Bernstein will also be honored. Proceeds benefit Community Works' groundbreaking work with children of incarcerated parents.
everyone. Good afternoon. You are tuned to 94.1 FM KPFA here in Berkeley and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. It is 2 p.m.